This is the Shaggy Jenkins Show on the Pacifica Radio Network.
88.5 FM, the voice of Maui. It's the Shaggy Jenkins Show on the Pacifica Radio Network. Coming up today, we're going to talk about how the alt-right is using clowns. Yeah, clown lives matter today, and that's a twisted story. Also, we'll be joined by a nefarious friend of mine who does rather wonderful performance pieces, and because of where we are in United States history, no more in this country's psyche is needed the tale of one Clarence Darrow. We'll also get into a little bit of some other stuff. Before we get to all of that, welcome to the show. Critical thinker, problem solver, guy with a lot of questions and weird hobbies. I am Shaggy Jenkins. If you'd like to follow the show online, anywhere social media is served, just look for Shaggy Live or through my email address, shaggyjenkins@gmail.com. Before we get to our guest and all of the fun shenanigans that they have, I want to do a little bit of a follow-up on the show because I never get a chance to follow stories as intimately as I am following the Wells Fargo story. One, because I have an account there and I'm kind of one of those people going, holy crap, what have I done? I have given my money to Beelzebub themselves. But two, because I think it shows a very interesting pattern of corporate greed and the nefarious and sometimes subversive means that they will go to get things they want. If you are unfamiliar with the Wells Fargo story, strap yourself in, kiddies. This is what's going on. Not too long ago, Elizabeth Warren, you remember her, she's that nice lady that says corporate greed's a horrible thing, founded this thing as a professor. It was called the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau. Yeah, the same one that was just struck down as unconstitutional yesterday in appeals court. But she dug up some dirt on the shenanigans of Wells Fargo and their CEO, one John Strumpf. Lovely name, that Strumpf. But what they've done, not so lovely. They have thousands and thousands and thousands of fraudulent accounts that they signed up their clients, aka people like me and you that just want to use a bank, without their consent or knowledge. These accounts, credit lines, and other online banking services tallied hundreds of thousands of dollars of debt, racking in millions and millions of dollars of corporate bonuses for CEO John Strumpf. Now, of course, when he was brought to a hearing in front of Elizabeth Warren in the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, it went just about as lovely as you could imagine. Yeah, you remember that old movie, Guess Who's Coming to Dinner? John Strumpf was not ready for the main course, and what he was served was a plate of accusations, totaling in hundreds of millions of dollars of fraudulent behavior that Wells Fargo engaged in under his watch. Now, here's the thing. He, of course, played the dumb white guy card. I don't know why we allow that defense in court, but the older and whiter you get, the more that you can say, I don't know what's going on in my organization. And people buy it. And that's exactly what happened. While the CFPB was investigating Wells Fargo and finding all of these charges of fraud and all of these acts, John Strumpf basically sailed through the whole thing, happy-go-lucky, millions of dollars of bonuses intact, and with his job. Well, now comes announcement that John Strumpf has been ousted, rightfully so, from Wells Fargo. No, I'm just kidding. He resigned, taking all of his bonuses, pensions, and lifetime stocks and shares and things like that. He got all scot-free again. One day I'm going to get to a story with a happy ending, I swear. But that's the latest on the Wells Fargo story. Justice has once again been put back in the refrigerator for another day. Not quite served, not even reheated in this case, just parlayed, as it were. With that said, I thought I would bring up a guest. Yes, I know. On this show, we hardly have guests, but every so often I get lonely and want friends. One of these guys that I sucker into coming onto my show from time to time is an actor, and this time performing a one-man presentation all about the life of a guy that people usually associate with chimpanzees. Sad but true. One of America's most historically Darrow. Yeah, I know who it is. Robert here is just anxious to go. He's like, come on, can we get to talking about Darrow? Yes, we can. Because if you think about attorneys in 19th and 20th century and stuff like that, as far as influences, we think of him more as a monkey guy. But what he has done to our judicial system, and especially in light of world events now in 2016, judicial thought about crime and punishment, we probably really need to spend some time looking over one of our latest and greatest, I want to say, founding fathers of the modern judicial pushback movement. Social justice warrior before they even knew what that was. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the show. For the first time ever, it's Robert Angelo.
Good morning.
Yeah. Or good evening, or whatever. You know, the show's all over.
It's all one long day.
Yeah, it is.
Let me introduce Carol Lem, my associate producer and co-director.
Good, because I did not have as flowery as a speech prepared for her, and I'm sorry, Carol. I'd done a lot of research into the other guy.
What's that bouquet hiding behind your back?
Yeah, okay.
Shouldn't have.
Oh. But she is actually your researcher, too.
She's invaluable. I can't put a number or the importance of what she does for us as a co-director and as an associate producer, of which, and you know, the other associate producer, Brad Starks.
Poor Brad. Yeah, Brad Starks. He's star of stage, screen, and sometimes bacon wanted posters, if you ever follow him on his Instagram and
well,
stuff.
I have two packages of bacon frozen in my freezer for him.
Brad is also our invaluable social media director and creative director.
And photographer.
Photographer, copywriter.
Is there anything Brad doesn't do?
I don't think so.
Maybe next time we should bring Brad along.
I'll
to
tell
the show.
You this about Brad. He, you know, you would think of him as a jack of all trades. But he's not. What he is a master of all he chooses to jack.
Oh, yeah. I was going to say he's not a jack, more of a Bruce of all trades.
Okay.
But let's get a little talking about one before we get into my historical shenanigans. And because, like I said, the show is all over the place. For people here in Hawaii, though, you're actually giving a glimpse into the life of this man. Tell us a little bit what brought you to wanting to perform as a guy that is mostly known as, hey, didn't he defend monkeys?
Mm-hmm. Yes, he did. Actually, in my research for material, because I've been espousing to many actors that they should find one-man shows or one-woman shows to perform, because a lot of creatives do not have the opportunity to perform as often as they'd like or get parts that they like. So having a one-man show is tantamount, so actors can always go out and perform somewhere, and that's important. The play is Clarence Darrow by David W. Rintels, and it was based on the novel Darrow for the Defense by Irving Stone, which is a very popular novel, was anyway.
Because a lot of people don't know how much into defending things he actually was. Right. History books kind of, especially in the public school system here of America where we've given up on education, they kind of, I want to say, steamroll through his life. But as far as influential thinkers to judicial thought and judicial proceedings, Darrow was one of those guys that you kind of go, holy cow, this guy was, he was on it.
What I would suggest for your listeners is to go online and Google Clarence Darrow quotes, and you'll see some of the things that he espoused. It was amazing. I I researched it, and Carol has even gone further than that. Because she reminds me of things that I didn't even know happened.
Carol, are you a little obsessed by getting the details right when it comes to this man?
Very much so. He led a very interesting life. He was born in, I think, about 1867,
somewhere around.
Right around the end of the Civil War. And his father and his mother were both very progressive people for their time in a small town. Kinsman,
Ohio.
Ohio.
Yeah. And for people that don't understand, back then, being progressive in a small town meant putting yourself up for public ostracization.
Right. Well, I can tell you this, just to quote a line from the play, that he said about his parents, he said, my parents were not your usual people. They were free thinkers in a valley full of rock-ribbed religionists.
It was like that. It was a lot of stodgy, look, you have to conform, fit in the box. Mm-hmm. It was a lot
but
of
he
that.
Was brought up in a house of free thinkers, so he was already expanding beyond that, even from his childhood.
Right.
He went to law school at a very young age. He didn't really complete college. He didn't really complete law school. Because in those days, what you did is you went and you studied the rest of the law with another attorney.
Yeah, it was more of an apprenticeship program than a scholarly pursuit like it is now.
Mm-hmm.
They examined you for admission to the bar, not like today.
No. You take a bunch of classes, then you go prep and hope that you can spend some time with a paralegal or somebody to coach you through what their lawyer did to get to the bar.
Exactly.
Yes.
The thing today is the Bar Association is about as anxious to encourage competition as the Plumbers Union.
Oh.
Or the American Medical Association.
Well, yeah. And those institutions, notoriously friendly towards competitive practices.
Oh, you've noticed
did you? Robert just put his hands in his suspenders when he said that.
Well, Darrow did have a little bit of a tick when it came to the suspenders and to his clothing and stuff. He was always a guy that seemed kind of uncomfortable with the trappings of being a lawyer. You would kind of see him tugging at himself a whole lot during his dissertations and his openings.
I question that. I think it was more of a stance because it was very powerful for him to put his thumb in his suspenders, a thumb in his pocket, and stand there and boldly go where no man has ever gone before.
Yes. His suspenders were probably about the only thing about him that contributed to what you might call sartorial splendor.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
His general appearance was rumpled. At one point, I think Clarence has a line that he bought his suit in,
the Ashtabula Hardware.
And
Emporium.
And Emporium. And during the Scopes trial, some of the reporters said, well, you've worn the same suit for all these years. And he said, well, I buy my clothes the same place you do. The difference is I sleep in them. Now, he did take particular pride in his suspenders, and I gather for his era he maybe had a little bit of a wardrobe of suspenders. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So they were a prop for him.
Yeah,
so, and he used them very well.
It was his statement.
Mm-hmm.
Well, a lot of lawyers today have embraced the more bombastic stylings of legal proceedings from guys like Barrow, but not the analytical mind that he had for situations. When you look back at Clarence's proceedings that he was a part of, you see a guy that wasn't just into a little bit of performance, but as far as a free thinker and an out-of-the-box thinker, would you classify him as cutting edge?
In that day and age? Absolutely. Is he relevant today? Absolutely.
It is kind of strange, isn't it? I mean, we're talking at this point in history over 100 years ago that he was in courtrooms presiding over trials and actually tackling a lot of the issues that we deal with now. Carol, as far as stuff in your research of keeping Robert in track with his performance here, what has been one of the most interesting parallels that you've seen between the time of Darrow in the year 2016 now?
One of the first thing that comes to mind is because we are having such still unresolved issues of race in this country. Mm-hmm. And one of the latter trials that he tried was on behalf of a man named Ossian Sweet and his family in Detroit. They were a black family. That time they were called Negro. And they moved into a white neighborhood. And the neighborhood immediately formed a neighborhood improvement association and protested. And they kind of staked out the house and marched on it and were behaving as a mob. His brother arrived and people threw rocks at him as he entered the house. The people inside the house were armed because they feared for their lives and their property, and they fired into the crowd, and they unfortunately killed a white man. All 11 were arrested. Mr. Darrow's defense of Ossian Sweet, who was being tried strictly as murder by 12 white men, was that it's not a case of murder, it is a case of racial prejudice. Mm. And he took it on head on and addressed it for what it was.
Now, we're talking about an era when this was going on, mm-hmm. predating Jim Crow segregation laws and the Dixiecrats' rise mm-hmm. in the South.
Yes.
That is amazing
yeah.
when you put it in that type of historical context. He was fighting to show that people could be guilty of racial profiling and racial prejudice in a time where yeah. we didn't even accept races as all being equal.
No, and it was not a case of, we had not risen to the sophistication of profiling. It was racial prejudice. Mm-hmm. But he addressed it in the form of, we're all a bundle of prejudices. We're prejudiced against people's religions and where they live and even what they wear and how they look.
And especially their color.
Well, I was about to ask you.
Especially their color.
Robert, because when you're going through to research this, I know it is a lot of quotes, it is a lot of historical mm-hmm. facts, but getting into the actual heart of the character, stories like this kind of point to, what would you say would be the defining core of somebody
his
like
childhood.
Darrow?
His childhood. When he was a young boy,
yes.
he was influenced by his father telling him stories about murders that were committed in nearby towns. And one specific one affected his father so strongly that it affected him for the rest of his life. And therefore, young Darrow chose to fight for that. He always believed in the sanctity of life and never to see a death penalty.
Wow.
That's what he fought against, the death penalty. He'd rather see a man go to jail than life be taken. As preventing a second murder is basically what he did.
Dang.
Yeah.
Well, I tell you what, guys, I've got to take a quick break here. When we come back in a sec, I want to pick up and start talking about some of the specifics. And then, you know, because you're performing in this play and you're embracing this character, I want to get your thoughts from Darrow's perspective mm-hmm. on some of our weird modern events. All right, for everybody else, stay close. I assure you, a very educational experience awaits you on the other side of this break. It's the Shaggy Jenkins Show.
Get involved, get informed. This is the Shaggy Jenkins Show on the Pacifica Radio Network.
88.5 FM, the voice of Maui. It's the Shaggy Jenkins Show on the Pacifico Radio Network. Welcome back to it. We are having a very educational proceeding today. In just a little bit, I'll talk to you about how clowns' lives actually do matter. But because they do that online, it's actually... Okay, look, let's just be honest. Clowns right now in the United States history... are, there's a creepy clown epidemic going around, and just in time for the holidays. A guy, though, that probably would defend anybody's right to go out and clown around openly would be, I guess you could say, as far as history is concerned, one of the most forward-thinking defense attorneys in United States history. That would be Clarence Darrow. And playing him... You love how I say that, don't you?
I knew you were going to lead into that, and congratulations, you did.
And performing that is a guy that is definitely into a little clowning around himself, but very serious actor, Robert Angelou.
I'm only serious about not being serious.
well. As serious as this guy was, right. Is this a fun role for you?
Absolutely. I identify so strongly with what this man stood for, what he fought for, and his beliefs that it's like putting on a second skin.
Mm.
But I want to say this about Clarence Darrow. Everyone thinks of him as the staid attorney, but that's not who he was.
Every powerful man throughout history has a duality of nature. Mm-hmm. And just as serious and as progressive as he was kind of a, hey, fellas, let's go kick a six-pack down by the river.
Well, it was more whiskey, but that's okay.
Yeah, well, yeah.
But
that's lawyer money talking. In radio, really? We can afford beer.
Well, that was his first initial hit on being a lawyer. He thought to himself how nice they were and how much money a lawyer must make.
You know, and we all started thinking like that, but yeah. Once he got into it, the trappings of his youth came back to haunt him in a big way. And as far as his attorney thing, that's one thing, but let's just talk about him off of it, because we are so enamored with, and at least I am, with how he thought about judicial proceedings, mm-hmm. racial prejudices and profiles and things like that. But as a private person and away from the public spotlight, he probably doesn't come across as tight-laced as everybody thinks.
Not according to everything I've researched and Carol's research. What, mm-hmm. what we found out about it. First of all, let me say this. In the old newsreels, when they used to do the old newsreels, there's very few pieces on him speaking before a camera. But when they talked in those days, they talked very slowly like that. And that's not who he was. Off camera, he was a fun-loving guy. He was a sophisticated country lawyer like that.
It was more of a Matlock.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. I don't
than
know
a Perry that. Mason, you know.
But he enjoyed tipping one or two shots of whiskey with the boys. He liked talking story with them. He was like that. And he was a charming man. He was also... to put it in any other way, he's a bit of a ladies' man.
I was about to say.
Oh yes, he was.
Mm-hmm. Now, what would you say was one of his most endearing charms, as far as people when he's not in a courtroom against them?
I think it was sitting around with his friends, mostly free thinkers, as he says, and talking about books and politics and.
And you think this is all kind of endemic of the small community in Ohio he was born and raised out of?
I think it was his quest for knowledge. He was a thinker. He was a thinker, and he loved literature and poetry and books. And so he was in his courtroom dissertations, he often used quotes from poetry and literature to accent what he was.
So this was clearly a guy that when it came to his free time, it just embraced life in all of its endeavors.
Yeah.
I think he and his second wife, Ruby, who was a reporter and whom he held in high esteem, I think they probably had a reasonably active social life among similar people, educated, people who talked about ideas, probably kept up on current fiction, but also knew something about philosophy and religion and whatever else the topic of the day was, and had lively discussions.
So this was clearly a man that enjoyed thought.
And let me say this about him. He had a sense of humor,
really?
Which doesn't come across in the books and in the newsreels that I've seen, which are very few, but he had a sense of humor. He loved to entertain people. Mm-hmm. He really did.
As Robert delivers this character, there are many times when it's, I certainly would not call it stand-up, but there is a... Yes, I did that, and oh, but not really. Mm-hmm. Or it didn't exactly turn out that way. Mm-hmm. There is a great deal of humor in this play. There will be many chuckles in the audience at some of them. A lot of his baseball player friends are coming, and there's something in there for the baseball player friends. There are, of course, we hope, many attorneys that are coming, and that this will resonate with them. And there are some lines that are just going to bring you an out-and-out guffaw.
Well,
they're hilarious.
There's one that's especially current and will be very relevant, and I'd be surprised if the House doesn't react very strongly. And so a line where he says, I was taught to believe that anybody anytime could become president of the United States. Now I'm beginning to believe it.
I'm seeing that come up on my Facebook
page. And the funny thing is, and we're talking like 100 years or more from today, and that line is still relevant. This is a guy that, you know, I want to say, like, as far as an attorney, very forward-thinking.
Right.
But when we get into his personal life, we kind of see the origins of this theatric style of presenting his cases. He was a person that embellished at least his words and his nature when he went to present a trial.
Absolutely.
And it comes from like this personal life of the arts and joking around and whiskeys over candlelight.
Well, he was very slick in the way he approached his dissertations and his summations. One of the things that was said was by a senator, William Borah of Idaho, after his trial. He himself was on trial for the McNamara case.
Yeah.
And he turned, Borah said, one of the people in the audience, in the gallery had said that Darrow had probably bribed that jury. And Borah said, Darrow didn't bribe those jurors. He just frightened them to death.
Well, I was actually going to get into that. Because, guys, I don't know if you know, on this show, I do geek. And I do geek very well. Carol is like, what is that? Is that one of those newfangled things?
No, it's geek.
Yeah. Yeah. I love researching things. And when we were talking about, because Robert and me, we know each other. The show is based here on the beautiful Isle of Maui. And this one-man performance piece is coming up on the 21st?
21st and 22nd of October.
Yeah. So if you're on Maui, if you're visiting the lovely Valley Isle, make sure you go and... You know, just bother Robert because he's always bothering me to get on the show. But I thought this was a great time to get you on the show because this character is somebody that I am just like, oh my God, history has forgotten how awesome he is.
Right.
So, Carol and Robert, if you won't mind, I would like to spend a little bit of time of going through some of the modern stuff that is happening here in the United States and what you feel from the play. Mm-hmm. Would be Darrow's quote that would match it.
Okay, and before we do that, since you brought up the dates, October 21st and 22nd, let me say this. It's at the McCoy Theater at the Maui Arts and Cultural Center. So if you can afford the airfare,
yeah,
please come.
And we can recommend some good places for dinner.
Right.
Oh, I'm telling you. No, you can make a lovely evening of it. I mean, mm-hmm. a real great... And this is one of those evenings that you don't feel like any dollar is wasted because mm-hmm. not only do you come away from a great performance, but you come away with this understanding of one of the most forthright thinkers of judicial proceedings.
And now, Shaggy, I'm going to put you on the spot.
Okay.
I have a ticket put aside for you. So when you when you come and see the show, you can talk about it at a future broadcast.
The sad thing is that because...
Pressure.
Because of my love of history and stuff, I would probably try to debate you in character.
But not while I'm on stage.
I get... Robert, I don't know if you know this, but when I'm not here, alcohol is involved.
Well, Darrow liked the few as well.
So. You know, but this is kind of why I like him. Mm-hmm. This isn't a robotic man. This isn't an unfeeling, unthinking monster.
He was colorful.
And his use of the English language was nothing short of brilliant.
Mm-hmm. No.
An eloquent, eloquent speaker with a marvelous turn of a phrase in some of his closing remarks when he... One of his unpopular cases was to defend the Leopold and Loeb case. Mm-hmm. Many people think that he defended them for the murder that they committed. He did not. They pled guilty. It took 6 weeks for the sentencing trial.
Yeah.
And his closing remarks ran 12 hours. The transcript is 42 pages long. You want to talk geek to me, Shag?
Okay, well, that's just it.
We edited for the play.
And it's brilliant language.
Really?
Well, that trial was in 1924. And here's something very interesting about it, because I'm going to ask you, and we see this all the time, and as a matter of fact, a little fun note here, anytime you watch any of those courtroom procedural shows, that bombastic style of attorney that has these flowery clips, that's based off the life of Darrow. That's basically our whole, what we would like to consider the mold for how we see effective attorneying in a courtroom.
I think it's still, I think his summations are shared in law schools.
Yeah.
I believe they are still to this day.
Well, the guy is the archetype for what we think of as a good guy attorney. But this 1924 case was very interesting because not too long ago here in the United States, and we see this from time to time again, including, you're going to hate this one, the Stanford rape case of these people that believe that because of wealth and influence, they are above any sort of reproach or law. Mm-hmm. And The 1924 case of Leopold and Loeb, where they went and executed the murder of a 14-year-old man by the name of Frank. They went and executed this murder merely on the premise that they were smart and affluent enough to get away with it. In 1924, Clarence Darrow used the first ever mental disability or mental disorder defense of his clients. This is the first time that that defense was ever uttered. 1924.
Yeah, something was wrong in their wiring.
Mm-hmm. That's what he said. He said, in the infinite processes that go into making up the boy or the man, something slipped.
That's one thing that people back in 1924 didn't consider.
Exactly.
Darrow didn't see, and this is the, how do I say this? America was a very stupid place in the 1920s. You know, I mean, we crashed the stock market. We got rid of the booze. There was just all kinds of stuff. But one of the greatest things to come out of this was when Darrow started to put out there in his summations, and especially in the Leopold and Loeb case, of we need to consider that not all men have a straight path from birth into adulthood. Mm-hmm. We are not preordained to be good or bad people. Situations, environments, including things like home life and stuff like that.
And hormones or the imbalance of hormones in a human being can contribute greatly to that.
He was one.
Look at how many people are on drugs today for imbalance in their endocrine system
And in a long time in our history, we were so simplistic, we didn't understand that environment and situation led to behavior.
Oh, yeah. So what they did was hang them.
Yeah.
Well, in the state of Illinois at that time, the penalty for the crime that the boys had committed was either death by hanging, life in prison, or I think it was no less than 15 years.
Right.
Probably depended on whether it was premeditated or not. Well, this was premeditated. The boys took months to plan this. Darrow's philosophy, his approach, was to save the boys from hanging. Hmm. And this goes back to his childhood when it opens the play, when he tells the story of his father attending a hanging. When Clarence was about 7 or 8 years old, Clarence was not there, but his father reported it back. He regretted for the rest of his life having been that close to an execution, to seeing the state kill another man for having committed murder.
No,
this stayed with him his whole life. That's why he did defend unpopular people and unpopular causes, because of these many core beliefs.
Mm-hmm. Well, as far as Darrow's quotes, though, because a lot of them, when we talk about people that believe that they are just above punishment, what would you say would be Darrow's quintessential quote from your upcoming performance that would kind of define his view of this affluence leads to innocence?
To temper justice with mercy.
It wasn't affluence leads to innocence.
No, it wasn't.
The boys were guilty. Yeah.
They were guilty. It was more of...
Without innocence.
Yeah, it was more about, how do I say this, about seeing them as inherently evil, born of Satan themselves, or as being mentally, like I said, something in the works happened wrong along the way.
Exactly.
He was one of the first attorneys to realize that something can change you. A traumatic event can happen in one point of your life, and you don't get better from it. You actually change the entire behavior going past.
I know one thing that he liked, and it expresses kind of his philosophy even about this, Robert. He didn't inherently believe so much in good and evil and heaven and hell. And there's a quote in the play about
his wife,
what he thinks. Anyway, you can, say it. That's him. Your part.
Yeah.
Well, he was an agnostic, and he was very quick to say that he didn't believe in an afterlife. That he felt, well, then when you died, there was no heaven or hell. Mm-hmm. But his wife had a different point of view. She said that she believed in a heaven and a hell, but it wouldn't make any difference which one he went to because he'd have so many good friends in both places.
That's a good one.
Well, I think in the life of Darrow, we do have to consider that he walked a fine morality line between good and evil. Mm-hmm. And he always did it with a very clear, conscious, almost like plan of where he was going to be next. Mm-hmm. And I mean, we could go into a little bit of the 1911 case with James and John McNamara when they were charged with blowing up the LA Times
Absolutely.
Building.
But let me say this about him. It wasn't only being a lawyer in court. He loved to debate and do lectures. Mm-hmm. That was another aspect of his life that it wasn't touched on very much. But in the play, it is. And we talk about his, he loved the anti-side in a debate because he loved turning an audience to his way of thinking as much as he could, or at least get them to think about things a bit.
Mm. And this was a guy that loved the cat and mouse of mm-hmm. arguments, oh, not yeah. just mm-hmm. having a side and trying to push that side. He tried mm-hmm. to explore everything a lot. Mm-hmm. And when we talk about the 1911 case, okay, now this okay. is something that you need to know about Darrow, is that he started off as kind of a normal contract guy, then he grew up into a labor guy.
His first cases were drawing up contracts for the sale of horses.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And he got 50 bucks from each side.
50 yeah. cents.
50 cents.
Was it 50 cents?
50 cents.
Oh, my goodness, yes, it
I was
back
like,
in
50
day.
Bucks?
I'm
no,
sorry.
50 cents by
He's
both right. sides.
It was. He got 50 cents from each guy.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's
that was
that's,
a big deal.
Yeah, that's good money, you know, especially in the small Ohio town that he started off in.
Ashtabula, Ohio.
Mm-hmm, boy, come on down and sit a spell. But when he went into bigger and bigger cases, he started to be a little bit of a labor warrior, and some of his cases dealt with conflicts, and this is the thing that people don't understand. When we talk about organized labor in the United States now, we see the union guys as kind of being the bad guys.
Right.
You know, we have this whole persona of, in silver screen and the small screen and stuff, of a union boss being this big knuckle buster that makes everybody tote the line so that they can walk away with their corporate greed, same as the corporation that they're defending the workers against. But in the time of history that Darrow was getting into these disputes, and we're talking like from 1906 when he was doing the, what is it? Oh, this is the Western Federation of Miners.
Yeah, the Pennsylvania Miners. Yes.
Yeah, the 1906 to 1908 and then up to 1911. We see Darrow as kind of the champion of labor unions yes. because organized collective bargaining was almost a death sentence mm-hmm. at that time in our country. Mm-hmm. If you told people that you were going to unionize or you were going to join a labor, Molotov cocktails coming through the window, bricks, your kids would be harassed, your wife would be yelled at.
Fired and thrown out of their homes.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And put on a blacklist.
And this was big, serious business. So now, it's kind of funny, in the year 2016, we always, when we think of labor unions, the normal perception is all those bad guys, but back in the day it was like the union was those poor bastards,
and that's the truth of it. He fought for the 8-hour day,
for
a decent life for these people. These people, they were losing their limbs. They were losing their limbs working in the coal mines.
Yeah, and told turn a kid up and go back to work.
And boys went to work in the mines at the age of 10.
Mm. Right. And
their little sisters went to work in the building next door in the mills at the age of 3.
Mm.
They were 10, but they were making 3 cents an hour.
Yeah, the boys were making. Yeah.
But it was a catastrophe for labor. They didn't have one day off all year long, not Thanksgiving or Christmas. They worked 12-hour shifts.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And this was the norm. And we talk about all mm-hmm. the atrocious conditions mm-hmm. with labor and stuff in the United States. Mm-hmm. Just think about how it could have been without Darrow. And when it comes to him protecting the underdog, what mm-hmm. would you say would be one of the quintessential quotes from him about his stance on defending what's right?
I'll have to think about that for a minute. Mm. There's so many quotes to go.
He was known for defending unpopular causes, people and unpopular causes, mm-hmm. which would go to murderers and alleged mm-hmm. murderers and those people who were trying to organize unions at the time, such as in Western Pennsylvania.
Mm-hmm.
My understanding is that they had no representation.
No, they didn't. This is
William. This was an attempt to. Mm-hmm.
It's William Big Bill Haywood, Charles
yes.
Moyer, and George Pettibone. Now, they were accused of, what is it? Yeah, they were accused of murder.
Yeah.
That was in Idaho, wasn't it?
Yeah, this was in Idaho. Was in Idaho. This was the Frank Stromberg, the former governor.
Yeah.
This one is the Western Federation of Mine Leaders. This trial was pretty big because these guys, Big Bill, Charles, and George, that was the three top leaders of this federation. And if they could be taken out, that entire union would have been disbanded. So the state really wanted to nail these guys, and Darrow was the only thing standing in that way.
Here's the crux of that whole situation. The person who was testifying against Haywood was a man named Harry Orchard, who was the lowest specimen you could ever think of.
He was your basic jailhouse snitch.
Right.
He
planted bombs in railroad stations, killing men. He robbed miners of their ore. He tried to murder the governor of Colorado. And this is the man that was testifying against Big Bill Haywood.
Wow. So,
but Darrow's defense was awesome. It was just, he just ripped them apart. And he fought for that. He fought for that, for Haywood's right to do what he did. He told them that he fought for the working man.
Yeah.
No.
Okay, I can still talk. Okay.
Yeah, you can still talk.
He fought for the walking man.
Haywood was the first one that the acting governor of Idaho sent people into Colorado.
No.
Or somewhere, and they kidnapped him and brought him
Colorado,
back?
Yeah, Colorado, yes. They kidnapped
him. It's illegal extradition.
Yeah, and brought him back to stand trial.
Right. And the new governor of Idaho, Gooding, had said that his exact words were that even though the United States Constitution guaranteed Haywood a fair trial, Gooding said that he would never leave Idaho alive.
Oh, man. And you know what? He almost had his way. Mm-hmm. Well, for everybody else, I want you to stay close. We've got to come back with one more segment. We'll talk a little more Darrow with Robert Angelo and Carol, who right now is scratching her head going, what did I get myself into? Oh, my God. And a little wrap-up of why clown lives matter, but it's not what you're thinking. It is the Shaggy Jenkins Show.
60-Second Science, I'm Christopher Intagliata.
This is the Shaggy Jenkins Show on the Pacifica Radio Network.
88.5 FM, the voice of Maui. Welcome back to the final segment of the Shaggy Jenkins Show. I am your host on the Pacifica Radio Network. No, that's not my name. My name, Shaggy Jenkins. ShaggyJenkins@gmail.com, at Shaggy Live Online. If you would ever like to drop me a line, feel free to do that. If you are planning on coming to the Isle of Maui, a good friend of mine and kind of one of those guys that ever regrets asking to be on my show because he knows I'm going to geek out on him, my guest today, Robert Angelo, and I'm going to say lead researcher and lady that keeps you in line, Carol. Carol, it's Lim, right?
Lem.
L-E-M. Carol Lim and Robert Angelo, thanks for sticking around on
pleasure.
The show.
But let me clarify something, Jaggy. Shaggy.
Jaggy?
Jaggy. Jaggy. Shaggy. Oh, look. What I was going to say is I'm not intimidated by you. I actually enjoy verbally dueling with you.
Yeah, well, at 4'6", I don't think anybody under a Smurf is intimidated.
Speak for yourself, Robert. I didn't know this was going to be a pop quiz.
But Shaggy, it's all beautiful. I love you as a human being.
Well, where can people go give you some love? Because this is coming up at the McCoy Theater,
that's
right?
That's right. That's
correct. And it's over at the Maui Arts and Cultural Center, October 21st and 22nd. It's one of those shows that makes Brad Stark so excited that he drops expensive equipment on the floor behind us.
It happens to be my equipment.
Yeah, well, that's why he's dropping it. If it was his, then whatever. You know, he's just like, I don't know him. But before we get out of here, because I do have one little story I want to hit before I get out, let's talk a little bit more about Darrow. Now, you're performing as him, and I told you that today we would go through some modern events and see what Darrow's opinion from the play would kind of be. And Carol brought up one that I think is very important. Give me what you would consider the quintessential Darrow quote about racial profiling and prejudice.
What he said is that we are all basically prejudiced. We have that going on. We're prejudiced against, as Carol said earlier, against other men's other people's color, other men's religions, other people's politics. Mm-hmm. We're prejudiced against the way they dress, prejudiced against the way they look.
Wow.
We are nothing but, we're full of prejudices, is what he said. We're full of prejudices. That was his big case.
But, you know, for a lot of people at that time, you know, like I said,
simplistic
thinking.
The juries were all white.
They were. And that's what I'm seeing. It's very hard for them to look around and say, I'm not prejudiced. Are you prejudiced? No, I like you. Yeah, because you're all the same thing. It makes it a little different.
That's what he said. You 12 white men are judging a black on racial prejudice.
Yeah, it's a little...
It's not murder. It's you're prejudiced from the get-go. And he says... And you need not tell me you're not prejudiced. I know better.
Well, okay, here's another challenge for you, Carol, who is now scratching her head going, pop quiz, pop quiz, pop quiz. Here's another situation, because Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton are now presidential candidates. And needless to say, neither one of them has enjoyed the taint-free version of a spotlight in journalistic coverage. When it comes to the character of quality of people, what would Darrow say is the best thing to be?
Champion of the people. Because that he supported John Altgeld for governor of Illinois. And the reason he did that was because Altgeld was independently thought. He thought independently. He fought for the people. He was incorruptible.
Wow.
I think Darrow had basic truths to which he adhered throughout his life. That leads to why he didn't necessarily think there was right and wrong and good and evil, but he felt that there were inherent truths. And those were very deeply ingrained in him by his parents. And I think he stayed true to those principles. Mm-hmm. He fought, his point of view, as I've worked through research from many of these cases, he was consistent in his truth. Mm-hmm. If you believed his truth, if he prevailed in his arguments in court, but I think he believed in very fundamental truths, and that's what he tried to find in these matters. And he did have certain points of view, like he was a very early opponent and a staunch opponent of the death penalty.
And that's where I was going to go next.
And so... That is a truth that he
stuck with his whole life.
Through his whole life.
Now, when it comes to judicial procedures and stuff like that, Darrow was one of these forward thinkers, and this is one of the areas that I wanted to get into, because earlier this week I covered the story about how the Department of Justice and Department of Homeland Security are getting rid of for-profit prison systems and the corporate prison structure, because they don't do what Robert Darrow felt was the job of the judicial system and punishment. When it comes to how crime works as far as the punishment side of it, Darrow's thoughts were, oh my God, where we should be thinking in 2006. He was a big fan of what was called rehabilitative incarceration.
True.
Now, Robert, when it comes to his views on anti-death penalty and things like that and the purpose of the criminal system, what would you say would be Darrow's leading thought?
Well, he said he would feel better about his work if he had seen some progress in the law since he was admitted to the bar 50 years ago.
Wow.
In his life. He did say that in science and mathematics, there's been the world has been made over new. He did say even in religion, it was a modified and more broader attitude. And he said, but the law and its administration have stood frozen and adamant, railing against time and infinity and the changes of our day and age.
Wow.
That was his point of view.
Mm-hmm. So he was, you could almost consider him the man standing on the edge of tomorrow with his views on things. Because even now in the year 2016, a lot of the stuff and principles that he fought against in his dealings with the legal system are still being debated
Absolutely.
And fought over.
Absolutely.
Yes.
And now, what would you say would be one of the lasting legacies of Darrow as far as how American criminal systems work?
Well, everyone believes and thinks of him as the monkey trial lawyer.
Yeah, the Scopes monkey trial.
That's, and
yeah.
So he fought about that whole thing, and that's not really where he was at. I mean, he fought for that, for the freedom of thought. It was all about to think is to differ. That was a big phrase of his.
To think is to differ.
Right. And he fought for that. But what he said towards the end of his life, he said, the 120, the 102 men that I have defended against the death penalty, none has ever been hanged, and none ever will be. Because I'd never take that chance again.
Wow. Mm-hmm. That is a very hardline principle thing mm-hmm. to say, mm-hmm. especially when, let's just be honest, in his day, hanging a plenty was a happening.
Yeah, outdoors, in broad daylight.
And he was, because the system at that time was, if it went to a jury trial and the jury determined guilt, mm-hmm. and one of their options was death by hanging, the jury decided what the option was. Was death by hanging or a jail term. He wanted to take the death by hanging or whatever the means of execution in that state was. He wanted to take that off the table. That was when he implemented the strategy of let them admit what they did. Mm-hmm. Take the death penalty off the table. That way the whole thing is tried before one judge. Mm.
That's right.
And one judge makes the decision. And so he pleads with one person.
And that's what he did with
to
the
spare
McNamara.
Their life.
That's what he did with the McNamara trial.
He did
trial
that in the McNamara trial also.
He convinced the McNamara brothers to plead guilty before they went to trial, and so he could actually present that to the prosecution. They were able to work out a deal where that would save the brothers' lives.
Mm-hmm. Mm. Yeah. And you know, this is the thing, because when it came to what he was actually the original Superman. It was truth, justice, the American way to Darrow. And as far
it wasn't the American way, it was Darrow's way.
Yeah, yeah, well, because he thought that the American system was pretty broken, at least the judicial side. But guys, I want to say on behalf of the show, thanks for coming on and enjoying this historical discussion with me, Carol Lim.
Thank you,
Robert
Shaggy.
Angelo. Both, if you're on the Isle of Maui, check them out at the Mac. It's the McCoy Theater, October 21st and 22nd. Call the Mac up for details. Go see Robert actually in character, because you're going to be surprised at this guy's life that was over 100 years old as the time the show takes the stage this month.
It's still relevant today.
It is so super relevant. You will walk out going, oh my God, why didn't I know about him? So if you're not a fan of Justice in America, get into Clarence Darrow and discover the true founding member of a real Justice League. So thanks, guys, for coming on the show.
Thank you, Shaggy.
I have a quick little side story here in about a minute and a half. Okay, let's talk about how people are mean online. Oh, God, duh. We call them trolls, and Time Life magazine not too long ago ran a story about how trolls are controlling the internet through their terrible picking on ways. Well, this is one of those things that started off as a good story, but thanks to trolls have turned out very bad. You know those creepy clowns that are in the news lately? Guys dressing up as clowns and just standing around, or trying to break into, okay, look, I don't know what's going on. Some crazy crap is happening in this country with clowns right now. But one organization, as a matter of fact, a clown organization, took to social media with the hashtag of Clown Lives Matter. Clown Lives Matter. The reason why is because all the creepy clowns are causing all the real professional clowns to get their ass kicked. So they were like, Clown Lives Matter. Well, then, we've talked about this before, the online trolls, the ultra-alt-right faction in this country that absolutely loves to mock things that are unmockable or at least need to not be mocked. Black Lives Matter. You know that movement against police brutality and stuff like that, which is, let's just say, a real thing. The alt-right movement hijacked the Clown Lives Matter hashtag and have been using it openly to mock Black Lives Matter online. Now, this is bad because remember how this all thing started off with real clowns getting their ass kicked and not wanting their ass kicked anymore? It's actually gotten worse. The whole thing has backfired in their faces. And like a banana cream pie, they're all wearing the stench of it. So look, lives matter, sure. Mocking other lives? not so good. Killer clowns? I've had enough. See you on the next show.